kind of a big question. Maybe it's a question you ask yourselves from time to time. I've been asking myself that for 30 plus years now, and I think I may have it narrowed down to a few things. It's already come up that I was in Missouri for many years, and now I live in Idaho, and they're two different places. I learned most of what I knew about grazing in a natural rainfall environment. Pretty wet, but 38, 39 inches there in Missouri. We moved to Idaho. The natural precipitation there is about 8 inches, so it's a little different. Irrigation, we generally put on about 32, 34 inches of water a year, but we control when it happens, which is totally different than getting a 5-inch rain and then nothing for a month. And the things that I'm going to talk about today are things that are essentially the same in all three of those environments. The high desert environment, and it would also be in low deserts, and natural rainfall, irrigation. It is in fact the things that really matter in grazing management. And they may not be exactly the things you were thinking about. We're going to get ourselves in the same philosophical position to start this out, though. We're going to start from, what does it actually take to produce meat, milk, and fiber? There's four ingredients for making meat, milk, and fiber. Carbon dioxide, solar energy, water, and then the last one there is soil minerals. That's all it takes to produce meat, milk, and fiber. Why have we made it so complicated that we have all kinds of equipment, inputs, all kinds of stuff that we use beyond this? This is the way that I view the land. When you buy an acre of land, you buy 43,560 square foot of solar panel. When you start thinking about the leaf cover, the ground cover that's out there, in terms of square feet, square inches, it changes how you view the world. Our primary business is capturing solar energy and turning it into some kind of saleable product. Whether you're producing beef or broccoli, it's the same basic thing. Efficiently capturing solar energy and effectively turning it into a saleable product. So every time you go out there in the pasture, you should be thinking, how effectively am I capturing solar energy? How good is my solar panel? When we think about water, we can think about it. We do think about it in two different ways. There is stock water that the animals drink, and you can go to Rick's office or any of the other NRCS offices, and they'll work with you on designing a pipeline system, spring developments, all those kind of things. But today, what I'm more interested in is the water that falls from the sky and makes plants grow. Because just like every acre of land is 43,560 square foot of solar panel, it is also 43,560 square feet of water catchment. Now, the carbon dioxide that's in the air on a day-to-day basis through our grazing management choices, we can't change how much carbon dioxide is there on a daily basis. Over the course of years and years, if we do certain things, we can help alter that big picture. But the solar panel and the water catchment decisions that we make every day determine how effectively we're capturing solar energy and water. Once again, every time you're out there on the land looking around, you need to be thinking about, how's my water cycle? Is my water going into the ground or is it running off? Of the water that gets into the ground, am I holding it there or is it evaporating right back out? Every day the decisions you make alter that. Other ingredient we have is soil minerals. And why is that so important? You buy an acre of land, you buy the minerals that are in that soil. Over 90% of the minerals that go in the front end of a cow come out the back end of a cow. We talked about that there's $80 to $85 worth of nitrogen and minerals in every ton of forage. 1,200-pound cow eats approximately 6 tons of forage a year. 6 tons of forage is $500 worth of fertility. That's why I'm concerned about where a cow takes it up. That's why I'm concerned about the time required for that manure pile to break down and the nutrients to be able to work out of that. All right. The way you actually create create new wealth from ranching is managing those ingredients. The other way you can do it is being very good at buying and selling cattle. You can create wealth simply through buying and selling. But if you're looking at the natural resource base itself, this is how you create wealth, by focusing on these three components. What does solar energy cost? Nothing. The solar panel costs us something. What does water falling from the sky cost us? Nothing. But our catchment costs us something. The minerals, we buy that when we buy the soil. So this is where, though that's free, this comes with the land. This business ought to be a piece of cake when your main ingredients are free. We need the animal to be the factory that takes those three ingredients and gives us something to sell. For some people, that's going to be a beef cow, for some a stock or a sheep, a bison, a goat, rabbits, whatever it is that you're going to graze. We need the right animal for our environment to be the factory to take the ingredients and create a product. To me, grazing management is about balancing ecosystem processes. Solar energy flow, water cycle, mineral cycle, and then the biodiversity that exists within our ecosystem. You don't have to know much about plants or soils anymore to be a farmer. Basically, you just follow a recipe, and if it happens to rain, you get this end product out of it. Grazing's a little different, because our harvesting equipment is a living, breathing organism. Because if you're in the cow-calf business, we have a production system that's out there 365 days of the year. It's a whole lot more complex than growing a monoculture annual crop, because of the dynamics of time, the organisms that are involved in the harvesting process and all that. If you want to be successful in grazing and make profit from grasslands, these are the things you need to know about. Just a little side tangent here. It's a what's in a name deal. What are we calling this stuff? There's a lot of terms that float around that mean different things to different people. Short duration, high intensity grazing. Well, what exactly does that mean? If you've been rotating cattle every month or two and you shift to moving them every week, well, suddenly that's short duration for you. But for someone who's been moving cattle every week for years and years and you shift to a day, well, that's short duration. And the intensity has gotten greater because we've concentrated more animals. If you've been moving every day, shorter duration is move them multiple times a day. So it's relative to where you're starting from. To me, if you want to talk about short duration, high intensity grazing, the grazing period is going to be something less than 3 days probably. For some people, it's going to be a day or less. Then we get ultra-high stock density grazing. What does that mean? It means we have even more animals concentrated per acre for a shorter period of time. For someone like me, who's been grazed rotating every day for many years, and stock density is the pounds of animal live weight that we have on a specific area at some point in time. I usually think about, even though it doesn't have a unit of time associated with it, because we rotate every 24 hours, basically, I always think about stock density in the context of a 24-hour period. When we were down in Missouri, we were typically grazing at a stock density about 50, 60, 70,000 pounds animal live weight per acre. What that means is we would have 50, 60 cows on an acre for a day. On the irrigated pasture in Idaho, we run more typically 70 to 90,000. What does that mean? 70 to 90, if they were 1,000-pound animal equivalents, 70 to 90 animals per acre per day. The people who do ultra-high stock density, they talk about 300,000, 500,000, a million pounds. That's pretty dense. So if you are grazing and the pastures, you're moving every day and you're grazing at 50,000 pound stock density and someone tells you, oh, if you want to improve the soil health and all that, you got to graze at 500,000 pounds. How do you achieve 500,000 pound stock density? You move 10 times a day. Because stock density is at a point in time, not for a period of time. So people doing ultra-high stock density are probably moving multiple times per day. Mob grazing is a term that in the last 5 years has suddenly become very common and people talk about mob grazing. It's not a term that I normally use because I don't know what it means. There's too many definitions, or if there's too many lack of definitions, there's too many interpretations of what it means. I'll tell you what it means to me. It incorporates ultra-high stock density. I think if you're mob grazing, you have to be moving more than once a day. If you only have one class of livestock, cow-calf pairs, and you're moving multiple times a day, it's probably just ultra-high stock density. To me, mob grazing also means that we have several, or a minimum of two, but it could be several classes of livestock all in the same herd. We've got cow-calf pairs, replacement heifers, finishing steers, growing steers, goats, chickens, sheep, baboons, everything just running together in one big mob. To me, that's what mob grazing entails. Multiple classes of animals moved multiple times per day. Grazing tall, what does that mean? It means letting the pastures get to a more advanced stage of maturity before you graze it the first time. The argument that proponents of this make is the taller above the ground the plant gets, the deeper the roots go below ground. And to a certain extent, that is true, but by letting plants advance to a certain stage of maturity, you create a stale solar panel, and there's really very little net photosynthetic gain when plants set there tall and mature because you don't have a good solar panel. I'm not a fan of grazing tall. I have done it, and I'm probably doing it wrong, but it cost me substantially in animal performance because the feed quality was so much lower. Here's an interesting term. André Voisin was a French scientist, worked from in the 1930s up until his death, I think in 1962. And he's considered the father of modern grazing ideas by many people. He talked about all of these different things here in the books that he wrote. The terminology that he used was rational grazing. Now there's no, English is an interesting language, and we have so many words that are spelled the same, said the same, but they mean completely different things. There's two meanings of rational in English. Logical, well thought out, we would consider that rational. And so we could say, oh, this is well thought out, planned, logical grazing strategies. And in English, that would make sense. The way he used it in the French was as feed budgeting, rationing out the feed. This is a rational approach in the sense that it's budgeting feed. There's no French word that means both of those things together. So it's just interesting that in English it translates out to two completely different meanings, but it's the same word. All of these have in common is they're about management, a higher level of management than just taking the stock and turning them out and letting them go. So we could say that they are management intensive, and they're all about grazing. Management intensive grazing is not a recipe. It's not a specific process. It's an approach to grassland management that emphasizes planning, monitoring, managing, rather than a lot of inputs, a lot of brute force, or just turning them out. It's management that's being intensified, not the grazing. Animals will do all the intensive grazing you can stand just on their own. You don't have to do a thing. Just put them in a pasture and leave them there for 6 months, and it'll get intensively grazed. Only people can intensively manage. And so that's why I always write it this way, with a hyphen and a little I. The hyphen is saying it's management that's being intensified, not the grazing. We could be management-intensive goat breeders. We could be management-intensive cauliflower farmers. I just happen to be a management-intensive grazier. A key piece of grazing management that has been missing for most of the 20th century is the concept of time, the notion that time matters, time that the plants are exposed to grazing, time that the animals are allowed to select from a particular area, the time required for the plant to grow three more leaves or five more leaves. Time is a very essential part of grazing management. It isn't only space, it's space and time. And when you bring time control into your management, that's what radically changes almost everything about the pasture and livestock business.